Hello and welcome back to the Digital Health and the Wearables series. Today I have another magnificent episode and guest for you, but before I go ahead, make sure you subscribe to the channel. Outstanding content there with the previous guests. And also let me acknowledge our Digital Health platform, Clinitouch V, and our series partner, Fujifilm Healthcare. And today gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Zen Chu. Is a health tech entrepreneur and investor, and also a MIT director of healthcare ventures. Zen, how are you?
Great, Joe. Thanks for having me.
Brilliant. We're talking before the recording. It's been a long time since we met in London, right?
Right. That was a whole phase of digital health ago.
Yeah, my very beginnings. Yeah, I remember. Fantastic. Thank you so much for accepting the invite and for being in here. I've been following your magnificent work. And today we are here to talk about digital health funding and also impact. So the first question that I have for you is, what is the origin of MIT's hacking medicine and what has been its impact?
Sure. Well, we started 11 years ago. We just had our... during the pandemic, our celebration of our first decade. And the important thing to know is it's a student-led organization, right? It's graduate students and undergrads. We founded it that way in order to make sure that it was always true to what the students wanted and not become, you know, a center within an academic institution and a beast to be fed. And but from the very beginning, we were trying to think about healthcare and medicine differently. We didn't want to title our effort yet another healthcare innovation program. So we titled it Hacking Medicine to take the hacking ethos, which has a long history at MIT, and apply it to healthcare. You know, we need more outsiders. We need more technologists because technology helps medicine scale beyond the two hands of a healthcare practitioner. And someone needed a champion, and we wanted to be that for folks while teaching the students the techniques and the frameworks to put on events. We've now put on events in over 100 events in over 30 countries around the world because every health system is local. And has differences, and you need to kind of start where they are, whether that's in an emerging country or in a developed country or in the messed up healthcare system that is our U.S. healthcare system that the pandemic has revealed. But all of those systems really need a hacking mentality to figure out how to, you know, take this massive digital transformation of healthcare from the phase that it's in into the future inevitabilities. And out of, not only have we trained over 10,000 people in a process at these hackathons, we've had virtual hackathons around the world during the pandemic, using thousands of folks' intellect to think differently and come up with solutions to solve for COVID and other health problems during the pandemic. And out of this ecosystem, over $500 million in professional venture capital has gone into dozens of startups, many of whom we don't even track because there are so many. Or, you know, we knew the first startup, but we didn't know the second one. And so, you know, all these folks come back into the ecosystem, and we are just in the best time in the history of medicine to be doing what we're doing as technologists and as healthcare professionals, you know, and the mix of on teams of both of those.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. Well, truly amazing that you put on over 100 events so far. Much needed, you know, to really break into different places and bring everyone together. Thank you for that. The second question that I have for you is, what do you teach in your graduate course in MIT Healthcare Ventures?
We really teach very similar to hacking medicine. You know, first of all, we teach that healthcare is not one monolith in each country. It is over $1,000 billion niches just in the US alone. And you really need to think in terms of the jobs to be done and, you know, agile methodologies that we take from Silicon Valley as best practices, but really adapt them to the complexities of healthcare, because you've got so many more stakeholders that matter. You've got to be cautious because this is healthcare. This is acute care. These are lives on the line. And so, you know, a regular hacking mentality doesn't fit when you have lives on the line. But we also teach them about regulatory and patents and everything that you need to really package up into a healthcare venture with a business model that works. And it's the business models that are changing. I think if there are pillars to what we teach, it's first that tech scales medicine. And that changes the new technologies, the new connected medical devices, the pill plus strategies in pharma, really change healthcare workflows and the healthcare journey of patients. You can redesign and re-engineer those healthcare experiences. But amid the tectonic shifts in healthcare, you know, the cracks that appear, which are opportunities, are not being filled and not being addressed by the big incumbent organizations. The big pharmas, the big hospital systems, the big insurance companies, they are so slow to adopt and adapt, and they're trapped in some of their business models. And it's really the entrepreneurs that can fill those gaps and bring care, a new kind of care, faster.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you so much. You said something really inspiring, like the technology scales medicine. That I really like that. Brilliant. Moving on to the third question is, how are you seeing outsiders and tech ventures funds changing digital health?
Yes, absolutely. You know, in the old days, only healthcare ventures invested in healthcare, invested in, you know, a new medical device or a new biotech company. But what we're seeing now is a groundswell of traditionally tech investors and refugees from tech companies. You know, they may have made their money at a startup or at Facebook and get disillusioned and are thinking about doing, you know, what are they doing next? And they come to a healthcare mission. You know, one of the companies I'm involved with, I'm lucky to be involved in, just hired the CEO of Siri that sold to Apple, and he's come in to a, you know, a fantastic digital health breakthrough in Riva Health. And that's because of the health mission, right? And, you know, that's the energy you can harness from entrepreneurs, from techies, and from health, from traditional tech VCs that want to fund health missions. And they're actually often more valuable as investors because they understand the tech stack and, you know, viral coefficients and basic things about getting a small startup out and having traction early, that they have different muscles than traditional biotech and healthcare venture investors. And so we welcome them. We need that outside energy. We need those fresh eyes on these problems. Because the incumbent organizations and the old doctors, you know, are stuck in their ways, and, you know, there is a better way. And the fun thing about healthcare is that you've got these gold standards of outcomes, of evidence-based medicine, and you can measure the gaps, and you can invest in inevitabilities. And, you know, people can debate whether that's an inevitability in 20 years or in 5 years, but those of us that get to invest in early stage healthcare ventures get to accelerate some of that progress for patients that, you know, that these teams care about.
Brilliant, thank you so much. And the last question that I have for you is, and we're both very passionate about wearables, so I have to talk about wearables. The last question is, how are wearables and new biometrics changing healthcare?
Sure. So, you know, there has been a sea change. First, it's that folks can measure that, and have insights in their own behaviors, right? But obviously, you can extrapolate from these new biometrics, and professional clinicians can use them as new biometrics. You've got to prove the outcomes that of how you, you know, kind of measure something, and maybe it's, you know, photoplethysmography, right, on a wearable device, and you've got heart rate. But the fact that you have more samples in between, as opposed to visiting your cardiologist once every 3 months when you have an issue, you know, they get a window into this, and that data and those charts become new kinds of biometrics. And so we emphasize that in our classes too, for how to think about wearables as new kinds of biometrics spewing off data, and how do you then generate that into evidence that clinicians can trust has been, you know, proven associated with a disease state or a wellness state. And you know, we wouldn't have that without the devices, but we also need dashboards, and we need things to save clinicians time so that they can efficiently integrate that into their, you know, patient interactions.
Brilliant, Zen, thank you so much. Fascinating conversation. We could talk for hours around these subject matters. Anyway, you can
come to class.
Yeah, I know. Maybe I could come to a few classes to learn more. Thank you so much for being in here, and for your amazing insights and contribution. Before I round up, it's not really a question as such. I finish all my episodes with 1 minute of fame. You can talk about anything, your work, personal life, achievements, a shout out to any companies, anything whatsoever. To round up, over to you, 1 minute of fame.
Oh, well, I'll just talk about our students. They're doing fantastic work. Jonathan Eng founded Iterative Scopes, and a couple of weeks ago announced a new $150 million into his round using AI to look through scopes, surgical scopes, for colonoscopies and other gastroenterology applications, right? But it started in our class, a standing start, and they've done amazing work. PillPack came out of our class, which raised over $120 million and sold for $1 billion to Amazon, and is really the cornerstone for their healthcare strategy. Those are two students, Elliot Cohen and TJ Parker. And we have just a bunch more. You know, it's such a deep bench. Podometrics with John Bloom, who is ending all downstream healthcare problems with diabetic foot ulcers, with a mat that when you're standing for 2 minutes on while you brush your teeth, this mat is mapping your feet and catching diabetic ulcers sooner. And that's already in a national rollout with the VA healthcare system, Veteran Affairs healthcare system. And so, you know, these students are changing healthcare, you know, one area at a time. And each of these areas is, you know, $1 billion plus multi-billion dollar opportunities. So come to class.
Brilliant. Zen, what a way to finish. Thank you so much again for being in here. Nice to see you anyway.
Great to see you. Thanks for doing what you're doing. Getting the word out.
Yeah, brilliant. I'm going to round up now. Thank you so much again.
All right.
To all our viewers and listeners, make sure you subscribe to the channel. Also acknowledge our digital health platform, Clinitouch V, our series partner, Fujifilm Healthcare, and also connect with Zen. I'm going to post his LinkedIn and Twitter here. Ask him questions about any innovations, about what he's involved with, his magnificent work. And I'll see you all next week.
And everyone can come to Hacking Medicine events. So just check out hackingmedicine.mit.edu.
Brilliant. Thank you, Zen. I'll see you all next week.
Thank you.